We continue our exploration of 18th century history this afternoon with a paper by Lois Dubin. Lois Dubin is Associate Professor of Religion and Biblical Literature at Smith College in Northampton, Massachusetts. Her major field of research is 18th and 19th century Jewish cultural and political history, primarily in Habsburg, Central Europe, and Italy. Her forthcoming book, Port Jews, Privilege, and Enlightenment in Habsburg, Trieste, to be published by Stanford University Press, is a study of the Enlightenment, Old Regime politics, and modern Jewish history. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Lois Dubin.
Okay, now we're going to do a little transfer here. Oops, I've got it stuck on me. Okay, now where we
just do it.
Okay.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Higher up, higher up.
We'll just keep trying till we get it right.
Is that good?
Can you hear me?
Very good.
Yes, okay. Thank you. Colleagues and friends, thank you for the invitation to be here and to share in your gracious hospitality. I admire your desire to learn and your patience, and we've had a lot of sessions. The hour is late. I even understand there's a football game, which is very much on some people's minds. But I can't do anything about that, so you'll do your best, I will do my best, and we'll hope for the best. The conference publicity posed the question, were the Enlightenment and the Emancipation good for the Jews? I could be facetious and simply answer to this audience and in this forum, well, of course the Enlightenment was good. After all, how could there be an international institute for secular humanistic Judaism if there hadn't been the Enlightenment? But I'd really like to approach the matter somewhat differently. What is usually involved when people ask this question, was the Enlightenment good for the Jews? Is this really a question of historical judgment, of ideology, or a reading of contemporary reality? And why do so many people still get so excited and so agitated about the Enlightenment and its Jewish variant, the Haskalah? I propose that we consider an image of an accordion, an instrument which is played both by compression and by expansion. Of course, I don't play the accordion, so this is what I surmise from distant observation, and I hope I'm correct. In a sense, I want to address the question of the Enlightenment and the Jews as if playing an accordion. What do I mean by that? First, extended. I want to start from a recognition of the great spread, the formative impact of the Enlightenment and the Haskalah over the last two centuries of Jewish history. But I propose that we then try to compress the accordion and see the Enlightenment and Haskalah as discrete 18th and 19th century historical phenomena. In other words, that we try to delineate, circumscribe, reduce the Enlightenment and Haskalah to their proper 18th and 19th century manageable proportions. And in so doing, we try to avoid making the Jewish Enlightenment synonymous with or responsible for everything that's happened since to Jews. However, having done this compression, we recognize, however, that the Enlightenment and the Haskalah produced values which have a long afterlife, values which are useful in sorting one's way through the contradictory trends and claims of our post-Holocaust Jewish world, a variegated world of diaspora Jewries and a Jewish state. So in recognizing that the Enlightenment, that Enlightenment and Haskalah values are still at play, in play, and at stake in our world, we have again opened up or extended the accordion. Because the Enlightenment and the Haskalah are both historical and live issues, people often paint them in very broad strokes. We're probably all aware that for many, the vision, the picture looks like this. Before the Enlightenment, it was all darkness. After the Enlightenment, there was great light. Or, for many critics of the Enlightenment, the picture has been quite the reverse. Before the Enlightenment, it was all light. And after the Enlightenment, it's been, there's been great darkness and dissension. I myself really subscribe to neither of these paradigms. But in my remarks today, I'll try to contract and contextualize the Enlightenment and the Haskalah and avoid seeing them as coterminous or responsible for all of subsequent Jewish history. Yet, I'll also try to speak about their relevance for our own day. And I admit my perspective at the outset. I accept the Enlightenment and the Haskalah as givens. I cannot imagine our present world without them. And I do think they bespeak values and ideals which, however flawed, however unrealistic, still do provide some significant guideposts today. So let's go over some material which I hope is not too familiar, but let's talk briefly about what was the Enlightenment and what was the Haskalah. The Enlightenment, of course, was an intellectual cultural movement of 18th century Europe whose exponents engaged critical intellectuals such as Locke, Voltaire, Montesquieu, Rousseau, Kant, the encyclopedists, popularized the new science and philosophy of the 17th century. And they brought to bear their rationalist, empiricist, and naturalist premises, brought those to bear on every sphere of science and society. And with reason, nature, experience, and utility as their fundamental watchwords and norms, they criticized the institutions and traditions of old regime Europe, especially the well-established Catholic Church. And they forged a this-worldly, human-centered worldview and activist stance. I imagine I haven't said anything new to this audience until this point. The key was understood to be intellectual autonomy and daring. As in Kant's famous formulation, dare to know. Have the courage to make use of your own understanding. And that means looking at things afresh, in rational terms, not taking traditions and institutions as given. Enlighteners believed that a strong dose of autonomous critical reason could dispel the superstition or obscurantism which encrusted existing institutions and ways of thinking. In other words, that they could provide light which would significantly improve the real world and contribute to human progress. So a sense of liberation through reason, through knowledge, and through science. And an important component in this worldview was a stress on universals and on individuals' abilities to know universals. The most important universal being reason and linked to it the idea of common humanity, that everyone is human by virtue of being, everybody shares in a common humanity by virtue of possessing reason. And that ultimately the similarities among human beings are more significant than the differences. Now, one well-known focus of attention for Enlightenment intellectuals was, of course, religion. Now, some of the basic assumptions concerning religion, I'll just review them. Individual autonomy, which meant that individuals are responsible for their own happiness and eternal salvation. That means that the state is not responsible for that. The state is understood to be a civil, a secular institution, whose purpose is to be a civic commonwealth to accomplish worldly, mundane, political, and so on purposes. A corollary of this is that such a state has a civil need for religious toleration. A well-known Enlightenment maxim is that intolerance, religious intolerance, begets civil strife, and tolerance begets civil peace. A secular and utilitarian definition of the ideal person emerged, one who contributes to temporal society by being useful. Of course, I think I don't need to review here the criticism of religion on rationalist and historical grounds. On rationalist grounds, that much as much, especially mystery, ceremony, ritual, or, no, let me put it this. Much of religion is mysteries, ceremony. No, let's try it again. That much of existing religious mysteries, ceremony, and tradition, or subtle metaphysical dogma, is in fact irrational or unreasonable superstition, absurd, unnecessary, too particularistic, stemming from fear and ignorance. And the historical critique of religion would say that this, you know, derives from human scriptures, which have been misunderstood as divine and has been nurtured by wily, crafty priests and unreasonable human, unreliable human traditions. So what I've summarized, many of you know in the famous Voltaire's famous slogan, get rid of the infamous, meaning religion. But in fact, even within the Enlightenment itself, there were other more moderate voices with regard to religion. Some looked at existing religions and came up with a theoretical construct of natural religion and said there's a core of a universal, natural, rational core existing in all religions, despite what's become encrusted around them. And this would include, to most Enlightenment thinkers in the 18th century, a simple, commonsensical, interior belief in divine order to be expressed by people in moral action and in humanitarian tolerance towards others. Some, in fact, tried to blend some of these Enlightenment maxims with their inherited religious traditions, and tried to use the Enlightenment, in fact, to renew and reinvigorate religious faith. And David Sorkin, a Jewish historian, has in fact coined the term a religious enlightenment to describe this trend of thinking. I would say what united both the religious radicals and the religious moderates was the conviction that the important practical applications of all of this were secular definition of the state and the need for religious toleration. And we'll be coming back to those later. So what was the Haskalah and who were the Maskilim? This was a cultural movement which began, Jewish cultural movement, which began in German lands in the late 18th century, spread through Galicia and the Russian, Polish lands through the 19th century. And it had a life of about 100 years, roughly speaking from the 1770s till about the 1880s. And the word Haskalah comes from the Hebrew word Seichel, which means reason or intellect. And Maskilim were those who were trying to put into practice reason or intellect. The Maskilim quite simply applauded the values of the European Enlightenment and tried to transpose them into a Jewish context. They saw the European Enlightenment as ushering in a new period in European history and in Jewish history in Europe, creating the possibilities, they believe, for Jews to become members of these rapidly changing civic realms, of a secular civil realm. The Maskilim saw the task of Jewish enlightenment as twofold. One was an internal kind of Jewish cultural renewal, that Jews should pay attention to the Hebrew language and to the Bible more so than to the Talmud and rabbinic law. And that was part of what they meant by a renewal within Jewish culture. At the same time, they called for acculturation, equipping Jews with the requisite linguistic and economic skills to be able to integrate with Gentile Europeans. That is to enjoy the promise they saw inherent in Enlightenment ideals and slowly being implemented by enlightened absolutist states. So theirs was a very optimistic reading of the times. And they saw the Haskalah as an educational program which could combat Jewish insularity and Jewish parochialism so that they could quit the ghetto, go out of the ghetto, which was now being dismantled legally from without. Particularly, they engaged in harsh criticism of their own culture, of their society, and of their religion, especially the power of the rabbinate. And this kind of criticism of religion was especially pronounced in Galicia, sorry to say, with regard, as you've already said, with regard to their contemporary Hasidim. And they constructed a new view of the ideal Jew and of that Jew's relation to the surrounding, to the non-Jewish world. The ideal Jew would no longer be a Talmid Chacham, a Torah scholar, but a person who would dress like a European and be familiar with the general branches of knowledge deemed basic and useful and important at that time. Things like German language, mathematics, natural science, history, and geography. And the first educational manifesto of the Haskalah, a work by a man named Naftali Hertz Weisel, which was published in 1782, used a very interesting term for this whole realm of knowledge. And he called it Torat Ha'adam, the Torah of man, or human knowledge. And I would define that as the kinds of knowledge concerning humanity and the world, which are universally accessible to everyone through human reason and empirical observation. And this in contrast, as Weisel said, that the Torah of God, which he claimed was of divine origin, and that the Torah of God was really the sacred texts and laws revealed to the Jews alone. In other words, a sacred literature of, well, where are we going to put the Bible? That's an interesting question, since that was already shared with non-Jews. But certainly the sacred texts of the Torah and the Talmud, that this is what the Torah of God meant. And he was saying that Jews needed to know something beyond their own religious literature in order to be able to function in this finite, practical Gentile world. And he firmly urged that this Torah of humanity be taught in Jewish schools before the traditional Torah of God, because it was so important, this new human, new in the Ashkenazic context, human knowledge. So he was saying that Jews should see themselves henceforth religiously as Jews, but otherwise in consonance with universalist Enlightenment values, simply as human beings. The famous words of the later Russian Jewish Maskilic poet, Judah Leib Gordon, be a Jew at home and a man or a human being on the street. And we'll come back to that famous slogan a little bit later. In sum, the Haskalah called for new priorities, engagement with this finite world and worldly success, and a restructuring of knowledge and cultural ideals in order to achieve success. I see two tendencies at work in this whole program. One was the constriction of Torah and Judaism from an all-encompassing way of life to religion alone. And the very notion of this Torah Ta'adam, Torah of humanity, represented the emergence of a new and autonomous sphere of culture distinct from, though still related to, religion. And of course, the very definition and the very separation of these spheres is the beginning of secularization within Judaism. Within the realm of Hebraic, of Jewish culture alone, the Haskalah also represented the first steps to the nascent development of a Hebraic secular culture by its cultivation of Hebrew as a modern literary and journalistic worldly language. So was all this, the European Enlightenment and the Haskalah, its Jewish refraction, good or bad for the Jews? Were they lifelines? Or were they, in fact, the plunging of Jews and Judaism into the ocean without a lifeboat, thus requiring another kind of lifeline? I want to consider some of the negative views. I want to consider some of the critiques of the Enlightenment and the Haskalah, of those who have seen these movements as the original sin of modern Jewish history. And I have three such critiques in mind. One is a critique of the Enlightenment itself, and two are critiques of the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment, one religious and one nationalist. I'll present them, and then I'll give my response. The first, in a very influential book called The French Enlightenment and the Jews, Arthur Hertzberg presented what I would call an anti-fascist or anti-Semitic critique of the European Enlightenment. It's very much a post-Holocaust book. I think it came out in the early 70s. Hertzberg argued that the Enlightenment, especially as propagated by the very influential Voltaire, was not a source of light and reason, but indeed the fount of modern racist anti-Semitism. And his argument, in fact, is akin to some of the arguments in general about the Enlightenment, which depict it as a major source for racism, fascism, and totalitarianism in the 20th century in general. So what's going on? It's well known that Voltaire, the champion of religious toleration, had in fact little tolerance or liking of Jews. And his writings were studded with charges of Jewish immorality, Jewish inferiority, and irrationality. And this applied whether you're talking about biblical Hebrews or Jews living any time, any place. There was no distinction. This one unchanging, unflattering portrait of Jews. Well, according to, and moreover, he considered the Hebrew Bible the source for much of the evil in Christianity. According to Hertzberg, Voltaire, and therefore the Enlightenment, revived the pagan anti-Jewish hatred of the ancient classical world, and thereby betrayed its cosmopolitan and universalist principles with regard to the Jews. On this view, the Enlightenment is seen as having a very dark side indeed, its trajectory leading all the way to murderous racist anti-Semitism and culminating in the Holocaust. My own view is somewhat different. I think it's undeniable that Enlightenment writers often talked a very good game about toleration and inclusive universalist rationalism, but when it came to the Jews, they resorted to harsh criticism and exclusivist prejudice. While asserting a common humanity between Jews and Gentiles, they often saw that common humanity only in potential, not yet in actuality. The Jews were often seen to be moral and fully human if and only if they divested themselves of their undesirable and noxious characteristics, such as association with money, superstitions, and own exclusive sense of superiority. This is undeniable. I can't dispute that. But as I see it, that's not the crucial point. I think the crucial point is that even that theoretical or potential inclusion of the Jews in a common rational humanity, no matter how much you qualify it, no matter how much you say it's only potential, was better than no possibility of inclusion whatsoever. On Enlightenment premises, one could at least make a case for the potential humanity and inclusion of the Jews, even if deferred. Many Enlightenment thinkers did not dismiss from their minds their own tradition-encrusted prejudices concerning Jews. But that does not mean that racist anti-Semitism of the Nazi variety developed primarily on Enlightenment bases. I maintain that it was ideologies and movements which arose in reaction to the Enlightenment and to the French Revolution, which diverged from the ideal of common humanity and proceeded to divide humanity into exclusive, mutually antagonistic, closed groups based on blood, descent, and race, which is where we still have to look for the source, some of the ideological sources of Nazi anti-Semitism. These were ideologies which could postulate nothing in common between Jews and the superior race, or between Jews and the rest of humanity, neither in potential nor in actuality. So I say it was these anti-universalist, anti-rationalist movements which were crucial in the development of modern racist anti-Semitism. It's true, the Enlightenment discourse and practice fell far short of its universalist, cosmopolitan ideals when it came to the Jews, when it came to blacks, when it came to women. But we ought not to forget that it had such ideals. So was the Enlightenment good or bad for the Jews? Was it all good? No, it wasn't all good. But it was far better than worse, as I see it. What about the Haskalah itself? What kind of indictment have its critics drawn up? First of all, I want to deal with the religious critique of Haskalah. Those who charged it with kfira, against the Jewish religion, heresy. That the Enlightenment was a case of, that the Haskalah was really false enlightenment, heresy, the destruction of religious integrity. And as such, that the Haskalah should be seen really as an outbreak of that recurrent plague virus, which we began to speak about yesterday, the plague of Hellenizing, of mityavnim, that the maskilim are new Hellenizers, new Greekifiers. I mean, that language is common today. One of Weisel's, remember Weisel coined the term Torah to Adam, the Torah of man, and produced this important educational manifesto of the early Haskalah. One of his early critics was a Polish rabbi named David Tevile. And he said that Weisel was guilty, among other things, of sacrilege and bootlicking. I quote, "This man is bereft of the sublime wisdom of the Torah. He manifestly lacks an understanding of the profundities of the Talmud, the early commentaries, and the oral Torah, the testament of God, his laws and statutes." So he was saying that even though Weisel said, look, this is still important, and that's one part of our religion, he said that Weisel was really not seeing the uniqueness of the divine Torah and its intrinsic depths, and that he was evaluating it according to other standards of literature or morality or the standards that one applies to all human cultural products. That Weisel and the Maskilim were judging Torah as a human creation. So the charge was that the Maskilim were reducing the holy to the natural. The problem was, as these religious critics saw it, was not so much that the Maskilim added a notion of human culture, the Torah, a notion of human culture alongside the divine Torah, but that they were saying that it was basically more important. And that they were saying that the ideal for a Jew should no longer be someone who was a master of the traditional religious literature, but rather someone who knew how to function in the world. The nationalist critique, which was voiced in Eastern Europe much later in the 19th century, proceeded along different lines. People such as Peretz Smolenskin and Ahad Ha'am really had no problem with the Haskalah when it came to matters of religion. But they charged it with a very grievous secular sin, bigidut, betrayal, namely cultural and national betrayal of the Jewish people. And the charge went something like this. They charged that the Maskilim had first denied Jewish peoplehood, reduced Judaism to a religious creed alone, to a faith, done away with the notion of a religious, of a civilization, in effect, and that this really led to a complete self-abnegation, complete self-denial. And that this was the decisive, the Haskalah was a decisive first step to assimilation and to the disappearance of the Jews as a collective entity. So they saw the Haskalah's central commandment as slavish imitation of the Gentiles. Loss of love of the Jewish people at the cost of the very Jewish self. And as Ahad Ha'am put it in his famous phrase, that this was slavery in freedom. It looked like freedom, but it was really slavery to the Gentile world. So these early Jewish nationalists were taking aim at the slogan, be a Jew at home and a human, a man on the street. They were in effect denying that this was either possible or healthy. Jews would not survive if they led such bifurcated lives. To live as humans, they had to be prepared to be Jews at any time, in any place, anywhere. Not necessarily as religious Jews, but as cultural Jews, or nationalist Jews, or secular Jews, as Jews as proud bearers of a culture and a tradition and a sense of collective unity. So these critics of either stripe often start from the assumption of a kind of hoary mythical past. All was right with the Jewish world before the destruction wrought by either the Enlightenment and or the Haskalah. And for many people looking forward to our own century and some of the terrible events of it in Jewish history in Europe, they find it all too easy to conclude that anything which promoted the entry of Jews into European society was fatally flawed, and especially the Haskalah, which placed that task clearly at the top of the agenda. I would say that hardly means, however, that the Enlightenment ought to be blamed for all the discontents and all the frustrations and all the structural difficulties in modern Jewish life. In its critique of traditional Ashkenazic Jewish religion and society and its call for acculturation and modernization, I think the Haskalah did sometimes reveal a shallow rationalism with regard to religion. I think it did overvalue the putatively universal. I think the Maskilim often had an overly optimistic view of the progress of humanity. And they often they were too naive when evaluating others and too harsh when they evaluated themselves. But nonetheless, having said all that, I really don't subscribe to either the religious critique of the Haskalah or the nationalist critique of the Haskalah, which I've just outlined. About the religious critique, the Haskalah did begin to create the sphere of secular culture, distinct from religion. But I don't think that means that all the Maskilim were in and of themselves necessarily anti-religious or even secular. They set in motion what became a great cultural conflict, a Kulturkampf, but I think Maskilim really proposed a middle course, a moderate middle course. What I think they were trying to do, at least initially, was to delimit, to demarcate the sphere of religion, to draw boundaries around it, to compartmentalize between the divine Torah, or then the Torah, religion on the one hand, and the sphere of human culture or other spheres on the other. And I don't see this necessarily as a destruction of Torah or religious values, but I see it as a reconfiguring. I don't think that a reconfiguring of Torah and Judaism and culture. I don't think that delimiting necessarily has to mean delegitimating. To say that the Torah should no longer be all-embracing, or even to go on to say the Torah should not be, Maskilim did not say the Torah was divine. Many Jews said that later. Maskilim tended not to address that question. But even to say either of those things is not to say throw it out. That's my basic point here. It's not to say throw the Torah out necessarily. About the nationalist critique. The Haskalah as a cultural movement was not responsible for the fact that Jews did increasingly inhabit a place in a civil society which included non-Jews. That there was a street, an outside non-Jewish civil world, as well as a home, an internal, familiar, maybe comforting Jewish communal world. The Haskalah did not create such conditions. It responded to those real conditions, and it formulated a strategy of engagement with the street, with the non-Jewish world, the modern world. And the core of that strategy certainly was the belief that on their own, Torah and a Torah world were no longer sufficient for modern Jews. And that to believe so was in and of itself a form of outmoded insularity and parochialism. I think that did characterize all Maskilim. But Maskilim believed in a Judaism in a modern idiom for Jews who would have to function both at home and on the street, and as members of a wider culture and society in which they would share important values with non-Jews. And I think that formula, that much maligned slogan, be a Jew at home and a man or human on the street, really was saying that to be a Jew and an engaged participant in the modern world would require a juggling act. That by necessity, a Jew would have a hyphenated identity as a Jew and as a human being. The Haskalah didn't create this multiple split-screen reality. It took the reality of those diverging components and tried to hold them together with a hyphen. So I see many Maskilim as having tried to steer a middle course between assimilation on the one hand, or total giving up of Judaism and Jewish life, and, on the other hand, closing their eyes to the existence of a non-Jewish world and a non-Jewish culture and non-Jewish ways of thinking. Now, I've talked quite a bit about the second, about the drive for acculturation. I want to say one more thing about Maskilim's sense of why assimilation, total assimilation, was not the answer. They often warned against false assimilation. This is a category that you find often in their writings. Let's remember, the Maskilic assumption was that people had been brought up with traditional Judaism, that they were steeped in it, but that they had to acquire something else. When they saw that that assumption of intimate knowledge of traditional Judaism and its inheritance was no longer valid, if, for example, they saw that the next generation knew no Hebrew but only knew German, then the Maskilim began to worry and inveigh against false enlightenment. That is, against assimilation without a firm basis in a Jewish and Hebraic culture. So I get now to my final set of themes. Is the Haskalah totally irrelevant today? Let's expand the accordion again. Why, despite the fact that this movement was primarily a 100-year-old movement, why not simply say it was dead in the 1880s, as the socialist and political radicals in Russia said after the first wave of pogroms? Or, as it might have been reasonable to conclude in 1945, when the promise of Jewish emancipation in modern European nation states lay shattered in shreds. Many of us cannot share the naive optimism of the Maskilim about the reception of Jews by European Gentiles and the progress of human history. Nor can some of us share their sense that religion and culture cannot so easily be separated in Judaism. Nor can we, whether we be postmodern or not, easily postulate reason as something universal or self-evident in its contents or its results. So what then do I see is relevant of the Enlightenment and Haskalah legacy for Jews, both Jews who are citizens in countries around the world and Jews in the State of Israel? For all Jews, I think the quintessentially Enlightenment belief in the efficacy of human knowledge and in human agency and responsibility is still relevant. The dare to know of Kant's slogan. And I would add, the dare to act. And what does that mean in the Jewish context? It means not relying passively on fate or destiny, but believing that Jews have to analyze the situation in which they find themselves and take an active part in shaping events in which they are involved. So not to bemoan, as we often hear, not to bemoan, for example, persecution as an eternal iron law of Jewish history. I think the Enlightenment is also relevant, the Haskalah is relevant for all Jews, with its principle of a middle path. Not closing one's eyes to the outside world, not slavishly worshiping it. So combining Judaism or Jewishness on the one hand and human culture on the other. I think the principle of a modernized, reconfigured religion in accord with intellectual currents of the day, that is of combining the street and home, of bringing the street home, being able to say that Judaism doesn't have to exclude anything that is not of Jewish origin. I think that's still a very relevant message among some Jews more than others, but it's still relevant. So I see the Haskalah message as saying avoid two extremes. Avoid the extreme of saying no home. Avoid the extreme of saying no street. What do I mean by saying no home? I think we can see that modern Western or American culture and consumerism or technology, even the latest in computer goods, is not a panacea. Even in Tel Aviv, even for Tel Avivian, techno yuppies. Most people find life richer and deeper through particular cultural or religious identities. So I think the middle path of the Haskalah counsels don't abandon Jewish culture or Jewish life or Torah in the name of a false universalism, or I would add, a complete faith in human rationality or science. How do I think the Haskalah says avoid denying that there is a human street? I think it counsels against valuing only Judaism or Jewish interests, whether one does so out of religious motives or nationalist motives. I think the Haskalah states that you have to recognize that there is a street, that there are some values which many Jews find meaningful today, ideas of democracy, human rights, liberalism, which may not have Jewish origins, and they don't have to have Jewish origins to be valid. And they're not simply instrumental. They are positive, absolute values not to be given up. And I think in Israel, the idea of the street also means quite obviously the Arabs in Israel and also the international arena. The street includes the non-Jewish population of the State of Israel. It includes public opinion. It includes great powers. It includes the UN. A couple more remarks about Israel, a polity with a Jewish majority and trying to define itself as a Jewish and democratic state. Certain questions are particularly acute, and I think the Enlightenment and Haskalah are still extremely relevant. Remember what I said, oh, a long time ago, the Enlightenment premises of individual autonomy, that an individual is responsible for her or his own salvation, that the state is therefore a secular institution. Well, in Israel, these questions are debated very hotly all the time. What kind of a state should this Jewish state be? Should it be a theocracy? Or can it be a secular state which operates according to a civil law? The Enlightenment premise of freedom of conscience and the freedom to act upon those convictions and its accompanying maxim of the toleration of religious diversity is a civil good. That brings civil peace, not civil warfare, that it's a political necessity to avoid civil strife. We see that being played out, the wisdom of that maxim being played out before our eyes every day. We call it religious pluralism. It's the old Enlightenment idea of the toleration of religious diversity in a secular state. So the Haskalah and Enlightenment are vitally relevant to the questions of orthodoxy and of orthodox and ultra-orthodox monopolies on religion in Israel. And it's no accident that the ultra-Orthodox do today sling the old charge of Hellenizing, of mityavnim, against their westernized or secular opponents. The other matter of great import is the very definition of culture and society. Is it legitimate for an independent Jewish society to draw values and standards from outside the Jewish tradition or outside Torah as narrowly defined? Democracy, liberalism, universal human rights. We get finally to the most basic Enlightenment premise of common humanity. And it's relevant today to help us with the question, can Jews see humanity in anyone besides themselves? In Israel, I would qualify it with in anyone besides Jewish Israelis. And I want to close by making 2 points about the European Enlightenment and its legacy in general, and speak to the issue of the ideal of a common humanity and of rationality. It's true. We don't belong only to the human race. We belong to particular little pockets, to particular entities. And identity politics may be very satisfying, but they're fragmenting. We must not assume that there is no commonality because of the evident differences and diversity amongst us. I think we must still ask the Enlightenment question, given the facts of diversity, what is common? What can be common? And what kind of synthesis of universalism and particularism, of universalist and particularist identities, can we fashion? About rationality, we know in the 20th century that reason and science and its application in technology have hardly solved the world's problems, and they can go terribly amok. But I really don't see an alternative to reason. Can an appeal to emotion, to the irrational, or to individual subjectivity, solipsism, relativism, really help us solve the real problems of the world? I don't think so. Perhaps the postmodernists are right. Perhaps we can't believe in universal reason as something self-evident, either in substantively or as a process. But I submit that a commitment to the process of reasoning and the search for human commonality, however difficult that is, and however much we have to qualify it and explain it with the particularities of context and subjectivity and all of that, I still think the commitment to the process of reasoning remains vital. And of course, I don't think I'm talking about a naive rationalism. I'm speaking in the name, updated to be sure, but in the name of the critical rationalism of the Enlightenment. And I believe that that tradition of critical Enlightenment rationalism, updated, taking account of 20th century realities and perspectives, can still serve as a signpost and a direction. Thank you.